very much. Thank you for inviting me to come along and talk today. It's a lovely venue and where it's quite dark and almost moonlike. So I'm going to be talking about Neo-Latin literature. So if you do fall asleep or maybe clap your hands, whistle a little bit just to try and get your attention back. So Harry Cadmonson was the son of a Perth Burgess family. Here's a picture of it. And he received an extensive humanist education at St Andrews in the Trinity in the 1560s. On his return to Scotland in 1570, he pursued a career at court as a royal chaplain, and, much to the protest of the nascent Presbyterian party in the Scottish Kirk, he was appointed as Archbishop of St Andrews in 1576. He was formally deposed, eventually in 1589, after a bitter and disputed row over the excommunication of the church that had been rumbling since about 1586, and until his death in 1592 lived in a state of abject poverty. During Adamson's period as Archbishop, the Reformed Kirk doggedly pursued a polity of communal church governance via a series of church parish kirk sessions, regional presbyteries, and the National General Assembly, and it advocated a strict demarcation between the temporal and spiritual spheres of the two kingdoms, as many of you probably don't know that. Adamson, by contrast, refused to submit to the Kirk's jurisdiction, treated the lands of his diocese, or his archdiocese, as his own expensive property, and pursued a career of governmental service that was mirrored that of his pre-Reformation counterparts. And Adamson was no Tolkien archbishop who simply held the office, as has been argued in previous narratives of his life, summary narratives, so that the rents of the archbishop could be known by his secular patrons. He possessed a powerful intellect and an exceptional talent for disputation and rhetoric, particularly in Latin, and used these skills to argue for a Kirk that conformed to the model of the Church of England, which was governed by episcopacy and had the monarch at its head. It's little wonder that James Melville, nephew of the firebrand reformer Andrew Melville, who we've already heard about from Jamie today, described him as a most dangerous enemy who, if he'd been endowed but with a common civil piece of honesty in his dealing and conversation, he had mere means to have wrought mischief in a Kirk or country than any I have known or heard of in our England. Now, we all have images in our heads of the people that we study, and for me, when I think of Adamson, Tim Curry, for some reason. I think of thinking of that of James Mason suave English accent. I think of someone who's a wee bit impish and a wee bit devilish. But I think that for people like James Melville and Robert Semple, the image of Adamson was probably something like this. And it's the image of, and you'll note the ruffs kind of match here as well. The image of Adamson is the diametrically opposed and villainous counterpart to Melville and his supporters, first appeared in crass and comedic form of Sawyer Hogarth. That's too good a picture to leave off. In Robert Semple's legend of the Bishop of St Andrew's life, called Mr. Patrick Adamson, alias Constance, his other surname. Semple's satire is a damning character assassination of Adamson that primarily recounts his delegation to England in the winter of on behalf of the government led by Captain James Stuart, the Earl of Arran. Semple's aim was to completely destroy Adamson's credibility at a time when a large body of Presbyterian exiles, including Andrew Melville, were resident in England following the expulsion of the Roman Raiders from government. And Semple succeeds in his aims. In the legend, we find Adamson shamelessly swindling and extorting money and land from merchants and fellow prelates in England and from poor quarters at home. He receives a beating from the Constable of Windsor Castle for urinating on the castle walls before a meeting with Elizabeth I. And he vomits on the moderator of the General Assembly during the confession of his many sins after a copious amount of wine. This view, minus the kind of bodily exhalations, was taken up wholly by James Melville in his autobiography Diary, by David Calderwood in his extensive history of the Kirk, and was ultimately enshrined popular historiography by Melville's biographer Thomas McCree, although in the 18th century there were a couple of more reasoned and balanced accounts of Adamson's life. So many biographical sketches of Adamson have been produced in the past 30 years by David Mullen and James Kirk, but even these fail to go beyond the accepted narrative sources of information about him, and they largely maintain the Presbyterian view of him, although Mullen did acknowledge Adamson's intellectual and literary skills. Only Alan MacDonald, in his fantastic article, Best of Enemies, which appeared in the Fish Strip for Michael Lynch in 2008, has actually broken from this tradition in recent scholarship. MacDonald shows convincingly that the whitewashing, or rather blackening, of Adamson's reputation carefully suppressed the affinity and friendship between him and Mill, most notably in obscuring Adamson's help and support in revitalising teaching at the near defunct University of Glasgow between 1574 and 1580. Now, you might ask in this brief of it, how do you make a biography meaningful? How do you make it significant? And I want to explain now very clearly why I think this study of Adamson is important, and then I want to give you a little case study of Adamson's very early career to show the ways he's been misrepresented in historiography. This will provide the first ever study of Adamson's life, and does provide us, I think, with an opportunity to revise and rethink our understanding of the politics of church and state in early Jacobean scholarly, stressing early here, in a number of ways. Firstly, the study of Adamson's political career is valuable not just for what it tells us about the most vocal opponent of the Presbyterians. It allows us to further reject, I think, and reconsider the Presbyterian black narrative that believed. And I've come to think of it as a black narrative because whenever I look at it, when I look at objective, non-church history sources, or look at records linked to universities, for example, I find that the narrative just doesn't stand up. To think outside these narratives in the future, looking forward in early modern scholarships, looking at other records, and looking, not depending on these sources, to really understand what's going on in James's early reign. And it's as a direct lens into the politics that I think Adamson's also valuable. Through his career, we see the gradual emergence of James VI as an adult ruler between his formal acceptance of the burden of the administration upon himself from the Morton in 1578, and his announcement in November 1585, following the ousting of the hated Adam, that he would no longer rule with the support of favourites. Adamson rose to power under the Regent Morton, briefly saw his fortunes wane when the Duke of Lennox and the Ruthven regime held control of the court between 1579 and 1583, and he then rose to the peak of his power under Adam. Again, he was really active until November 1585, started to fall after that. And then after the act of annexation in particular, really became weakened. In addition to his influence, Adamson was the mouthpiece of royal policy in the church in the 1580s, as you can see from his declaration of the King's Majesty of II, talk about his works. He was a major agent for the Protestant transformation of both Glasgow and St Andrews University, and revisiting university sources for this book struck at how important he is in that process. And he was also a leading figure in James's council and parliament until his sudden fall from grace. Second or thirdly, there's a wide range of MS evidence extant in the NRS, the NLS, and other repositories related to his tenure as Archbishop of St Andrews, as we spent most of last year gathering, and now beginning to feel my way through. Although Adamson held his post at the height of episcopal persecution, and although traditional narrative stresses weakness in the face of the General Assembly, as Archbishop, he acted as traditional superior of his lands and sat at the centre of a vast web of patronage and influence, which he used frequently for the most blatant and shocking acts of nepotism. Some of those acts were forced upon him, and when he's appointed to the post by the Earl of Morton, there is a bonanza, a liberal bonanza of pensions given out the very next day and in the weeks that follow. You can almost imagine sitting there with a gun to his head being forced to sign these chits as he goes. After that, in the 1580s, when he came into his own, particularly around the time of the Black Acts and the moderations, we see him active as a commissioner between Parliament and the between Parliament, Crown, and Church, doing a number of major church commissions and again university oversight, handing out pensions and the control of lands, particularly in Central Fife, to his friends and allies, enriching the pockets of his henchmen, like his brother-in-law James Arthur. Very close links with the Arthur family in St Andrews, caused so much trouble for the Wellman family, providing massive dowries for his daughter, and negotiating land transactions for his wife and his son. And these are just some of the examples of the many deeds, grants, and charters that we find passing through the approval process with Adamson's name on them. And again, there's even more that he's a witness to at council. And so there's a whole range of these things that I'm just beginning to get my head around now, and that's the next phase. Fourthly, Adamson published a considerable range of writing, virtually all in Latin, and comprising political and religious poetry, letters, and commentaries of church and state politics, which were compiled and republished with additional material in two volumes by his son-in-law, Thomas Wilson. And I've got the range of sort of core titles there, but there are many more that I can talk about. Adamson's writings are of immense value, as he was the only intellectual in Scotland in the 1580s writing in defence of an absolutist Episcopal settlement, but they also reveal a very different side to him, an earnest and serious-minded Protestant and deeply learned humanist who believed firmly in the Reformed Church of Scotland. This was no flighty and vacant archbishop, this was a serious man. Although his views on polity were certainly more flexible than those of any of his contemporaries. And in that sense, I find it amazing that his short and accurate tract on the duties of a sacred pastor, which is actually many ways in response to the ideas of church and canon, has been completely overlooked in contemporary scholarship. In the rest of this short paper, I want to focus on a selection of his short of texts from very early in his career. And since we're in St. Andrews, I want to talk about his role at St. Andrews around the Reformation period. And I'll be focusing mainly on the top title here, De Pipistarum in Emptius Aberdensis, or on the empty superstitions of the Aberdeen. It will give you a flavour of how little we know about Adamson and of how much of what is supposedly common fact is actually misrepresented by men. Adamson first studied at Perth Grammar School and he matriculated for his MA at St Andrews in Poor Scotland in 1554, graduating in 1558, he was a bit older. A major fact has been completely missed in previous accounts of Adamson's life, primarily because he has two surnames, Lewis Adamson and also Constance or Constantine. Is the fact that when he finished his degree, he then took up a post as regent of St Mary's and was there throughout the entire Reformation period. He didn't leave the post until 1562. A crucial fact that's often never been known before. It was in that capacity that he was ordained as fit to minister and teach, emphasis on the teaching, by the General Assembly in December 1560. And this also means, intriguingly, so I'll just start to think about the significance of this, that he must have first encountered Andrew Melville in a pastoral capacity, as a teacher, as a student. They may not have, they may not have been in Melville's class, but they would have been aware of each other, I think, and that's interesting in itself. The vast majority of staff who were attached to St. Mary's converted at the Reformation, and an epigram by Adamson was first printed, as far as is known, in his translation of the Catechism, of Calvin's Catechism in 1572, into Latin from an English version, suggests that he was present at the high-profile burning of aging Protestant Walter Mill, or Mill, in 1558, that's the text there. If this was written as a contemporary response to Mill's burning, it suggests that Adamson was already fully committed to the Protestant faith. Adamson was still working at St. Mary's just prior to his approval in December 1562 for taking up a ministry in Aberdeen if he'd be not chosen. However, he then took up the cure in the Fife Parish of Ceres at some point in 1563, but was described as such when, on the last day of December of that year, he agreed to serve as commissioner to the Assembly for the Propagation of Churches in the northeast of Scotland. The preface to Adamson's first known publication on the empty superstition of the Papists, or to the Aberdeen Papists, was written, Adamson attests, at least the preface was, at St. Mary's ex pedagogio, at the bottom, pedagogio. On 20th of August 1564, the fourth calendar of September, suggesting that even after Adamson left the college, he maintained an informal link with it and visited occasionally. This was a man well connected with the Protestant intellectuals of St. Andrews. The preface also shows that he took up his role as commissioner for the Assembly in the Northeast, an experience which had prompted the writing of the piece. And you can see there's the text of it, and it says, "In earlier days, when I travelled in the north for the purpose of promoting the gospel, lest I might be doing nothing in the utmost laziness, because the Aberdonians aren't listening to him, I wrote up some of the grosser abuses of the papists into a poem. But lest these abuses should lurk secretly among the Aberdeen papers, I have taken pains to bring them to light, and I may not begrudge the other men of this sect the smallest fruit which can be produced from these verses. Now, fair reader, that embraces these verses in benevolent spirit, the fruit will be yours until more cultivated things and weightier matters come into your hands. The De Ineptis suggests that Adamson's experience among the recreant Aberdonians was far from a fruitful or happy one. And given how long it took to fully convert the town to Protestantism, it's perhaps unsurprising that the task was defeated. De Ineptis is a savage 247-line invective against the Mass, the opening lines of which give a sense of the deeply anti-Catholic and anti-papal tone of the poem. This is the one here. I'm stunned at the kind of insanity which upsets you, papists, or at the whirlwind by which your minds carried away are snatched off, so that by the scorned word and by the commands of the thundering Lord, you fix human laws in your lawful ways. The Pope is the head of your company, the kind of man who modifies the world and fits laws, weighs out heaven, who is master in heaven, and frees souls from penalties and commands hell. Yea, indeed, that monstrous thing which Tartarus has spewed up from his foul mouth and is belched up from his black gullet, that lost man, that whom there will be no more faithful an enemy to Christ, and will strip Christ of his honour. Before you think, oh dear Lord, don't make me listen to another 200 lines of this. De Ineptis is more than simply an outraged and one-dimensional diatribe against the anti-Christian papacy. It shows a wide range of theological knowledge seen in both the biblical paraphrases incorporated into the text, the learned responses to various aspects of Catholic dogma in liturgy which Adamson discusses, and in the marginalia, which cite a range of scriptural passages of contemporary Christian writings. The poem also shows Adamson's devastating wit and impressive command of the register and stylistic effects of the Latin language for poetic purposes. And he begins his attack proper after the introduction by stating that there is no idol more monstrous than the Mass, and he says, no fable more suitable if you're after a laugh than you can see at the theatre. The Mass is an outlandish theatrical spectacle or spectacular, which in opposition to the more egalitarian celebration of communion among Protestants can only be led by a member of the Catholic clergy, a beast with a shaved head or perfect papal oil, as he says. He then uses an extended range of comic metaphors. The officiating priest is compared to a stage actor, thundering and shouting at the assembled congregation who bow and kneel before him in turn, but he whispers magic incantations and makes the sign of the cross. And he moves rapidly from one part of the altar to the other, shaking his limbs like an ape, and bangs little brass cymbals while gesticulating wildly at the sky, placing kisses upon the altar. And it actually says in the marginalia, it's likeness of an ape, just to make sure the reader knows exactly what we're talking about. Adamson's at his satirical best, it directly engages with the doctrine of the Catholic Church, derides the doctrine of transubstantiation for the real presence of the body and blood of Christ in the communion bread and wine. Stephen Holmes has argued in his recent work that Adamson used the poem to make a detailed rebuttal of the school of what he terms the Aberdeen liturgists, a group of scholars based in and linked with King's College at Aberdeen, going back to the time of Bishop William Malthusian. I don't think this can be proved conclusively, but I do like Stephen's argument. And it's certainly true that Adamson argues, in accordance with the Reformed doctrine, as you can see here, that Christ bodily ascended to heaven upon his resurrection, and thus could not be called back down in the priest, at the behest of the priest, with a few murmuring of words, and turned into bread, to be, as he says here, chewed up again and again, and to be inhaled by the foul mouth of the priest. My favourite part of the poem is when, again, Neo-Latin poetry is all about metaphors, striking original metaphors, and this is a great one. He compares the priest ceremonially uncovering, covering, and elevating the communion wafer before the congregation and then eating it to a cat toying with its prey. Just like the cat which comes upon a mouse, first goes around it in a fixed order and exalts the plate of its prey and afterwards devours it and eagerly stores it beneath its breast, so too does the shape-changing priest store itself upon that godhead while it is imitated with various forms. And see, covers it up and uncovers it and eventually leads it up. And then when he eats it, he goes and has a wee nap because he's so exhausted. Adamson also reveals reveals a glimpse or two of his academic experience of St Andrews in this poem. He condemns the theological trifles which the scholastic crowd fabricated in the chatty Sorbonne rail with which puffed up speech, clear reference to traditional Catholic scholastic theology in the central body of the University of Paris. He shows a general awareness of the history of the Reformation, praising Luther directly for his work in feeding through Christians from the tyranny of the papacy and the fires of hell, and stating that Luther foretold in prophecy that God will soon bring down another flood, as he did in the times of Noah, to cleanse the world. He makes further reference to an impending last judgment, stating that now the days of death are at hand, while the final section of the poem makes a sustained comparison of the papacy with the identifying characteristics of the Antichrist foretold in the book of Revelation. Adams ends with an impassioned plea to the Aberdonians and to whoever has concern for their own salvation to flee from the Sodom of Catholic teachings and to turn their minds towards being truly justified in Christ. And as I said, throughout their marginalia, pointing out the exact scriptural reference that Adams has taken in, some of the works that he draws on as well. The original printed edition as well, in the version collected by his son-in-law Wilson, contains two further short satires attacking the vainglory of the Pope and the Catholic celebration of the Eucharist, and a short but savage epitaph for the Catholic polemicist and abbot of Crossregal, Quentin Kennedy, one of Knox's major intellectual opponents. And this I found fascinating, and you can see the Latin text there, but it essentially translates like this. The poem is dated to 1564, the year of Kennedy's death, and what's interesting for me is that this really demonstrates the extent of Protestant intellectual and propagandistic network in early Reformed Scotland, even at the very beginning of the Reformation. Adamson was clearly aware of the major detractors of the faith in Scotland, and in the De Papistarum can be seen actively contributing to the process of condemning them alongside figures like John Knox in his History of the Reformation. It also shows Adamson's awareness of the use of epigram, and when he goes to France, he writes a range of epigrams for the leading humanists of the day, like Adrian Turner, and also George Buchanan. So again, he knows how to use these as part of a literary network. The strident anti-papal tone of De Ineptibus and the fact that Adamson devotes time and energy to producing not just one, but a range of poetic attacks against Catholicism during his first period of service in the Kirk, and the fact that his actual role as a regent in St Mary's as a commissioner of the Kirk has been so buried, shows that whatever criticisms can be laid against him in his later life, favouring episcopacy over presbytery and crown over flock. His first publication suggests his young author was a fiery and ardent supporter of the Reformed faith during his early years in Scotland, and I think he remained that way for most of his career, despite